We're not going to make any changes to our table in this video, but we are going to look at the database we used in video 29. I've opened up the table. I've also exported this database to a calc file, and I'm going to open that as well. Our single table has been working out really well for us up to this point, and often a single table is all that we need, but not in this case. We've got a couple of problems with the table the way it is. One is with our start and end date. What happens if an employee leaves the company and comes back to work for us? Well, we could give him or her a new employee number, so that one would not be an issue. But let's take a look at the phone number. We have a row here for phone number, but it doesn't say what it is. Is it the work number? Is it their home number? Since all our employees work for us, we'll say that this is our work phone number. Most of our employees will have a home number as well, so we'll need to insert a column for that, home number. And then a lot of them have cell phone numbers, so we would insert a column for that. Some of them might have a second cell phone number. Others might have to have us call a relative's house, or perhaps the number of their house up north where they don't have any cell phone coverage. Our database would start to look like this. We've got our home number, we've got a cell phone number, we got a cell phone 2, we've got a brother's house or their place up north. These last two columns only have one record in it, and this third column only has a few records in there. We would also have to change our forms to accommodate the new fields on our table. This is extremely inefficient, and we're making a mess of the table. There's a better way, and here's how we're going to do it. We're going to remove the phone number from our employee table and give it its own table. We're going to call this new table EMP phone numbers, and we're calling it EMP because we may have a customer's phone numbers down the road somewhere. On this table, we're going to have employee ID, phone number, description, and a field for notes. How we're going to connect the employee to his phone numbers is with the employee ID. We can see employee ID 0 has got three numbers. It's got a work phone, a home phone, and a cell phone. And we also have a note to call the cell phone first. Our second employee has got two phone numbers, a work phone, and a home phone. We would set this up for all our employees this way. Now is a good time to talk about primary keys and foreign keys. Although you just saw it, we didn't use the formal names. On our employee ID table, we mentioned that every employee has a unique employee number. This is the primary key for that table. Every record on a table must have a primary key. What a foreign key is, basically, it's the key that matches up to the primary key on the other table. In this case, it's the employee ID. Now, this field does not have to have the same name, employee ID and employee ID. I like to keep my primary keys and my foreign keys. I like to have them keep the same name, so it's easy for me to tell that these two are going to match up. But these do not have to be the same name. I just said every record on the table must have a primary key. What are we going to do for that employee phone number table? We can't have two records with the same primary key. We may want to add another field, put in an integer, and add auto-populate. That's how we did it to get the employee ID on our employee table. But another way is to put two keys together. If I put employee ID and phone number together, this could create our primary key. Each phone number we add for a single employee must be different, but two employees could have the same phone number. The employee ID part would make that unique. In our next video tutorial, we're going to create our employee phone number table, and we're going to populate it with the data from our employee table.